Oh, hello there, cyberdogs and citizens of the internet. I didn't see you creeping up on me like that. Yeah, kind of weird. I don't know what you guys are doing down there, but you know what? You're a little bit close to my gas, so, you know, back up. Get out of my personal bubble, you bastards. Ah, there we go. That's better. Hello, everybody, and welcome back to another episode of Minecraft Survival with me, Ren Diggity Dog. In the previous episode, we were working on the spawner pads of Mob Castle, and in this episode, my friends, we are going to be installing some epic redstone contraptions to start automating our mob spawning grinding factory of death. And it is going to be absolutely awesome. I hope you have some tasty ass beverages. I hope you got some crunchy ass snacks, because it is time to play some Minecraft Survival, my friends. And let me tell you something, man, it is going to be amazing. Now, in today's episode, we have got a ton of work to do. I've just come back to Mob Castle to prepare for today's episode. I've made a whole bunch of hoppers. I've made a whole bunch of redstone repeaters, some redstone comparators, which we've never used before. I've got myself a block of redstone and a whole bunch of other random jazz in here. Some more dispensers also for our spawning pads. And yeah, we have got a ton of work to do on Mob Castle today, guys. I am so freaking excited for today's episode, actually, that I'm trying to keep calm. I'm trying to not start shouting and talking really, really fast. But I gotta tell you, my friends, I am super pumped for today's episode. I've spent the last few days researching redstone, and I think that I have cracked the nut on how to install some redstone machines into Mob Castle that is going to help us to automate the whole thing. Today we are going to be installing something called a hopper clock, and we're also going to be installing something called a monostable circuit. Now, I know that I'm probably blowing some of your minds out there, but do not worry, my friends. I'm going to explain to you guys exactly how everything works, and it is going to be absolutely amazing. I'm going to blame you guys 100% for what has happened to my freaking jungle railway line. This is your damn fault. You hear me, you cyber dogs? Because of you, I have decided to make the jungle railway line even more awesome, thus giving myself even more freaking work to do. I thank you. But seriously though, this is looking freaking sweet. And this was a suggestion made by one of you guys. One of you guys said that the railway line was looking a little bit noobish because it was all the same height. And I actually 100% agreed with that. So I've done a little bit of an experiment here. And I have decided to not only make the railway line dip, but to make it dip at the diagonal. So making my life even harder. So, you know, we could have done it the easy way and just made the straight lines dip. But I've decided to push the boat out, see if we can actually push our design skills even further. And I think that I've done a pretty decent job over here for this particular dip. And I think it's just going to look so freaking awesome when it's done, right? As you're traveling along the railway line, you'll go down into the jungle a little bit, and then you'll come back up again, get this beautiful view. And I'm thinking that we probably keep this diagonal sort of up, because this is where we get the best view of Mole City. But then I've dipped it again over here, so we go down a little bit and travel over this little lake that's next to the Cyberdog Monument, and then we come back up again. And then we go down once again into Mob Castle. So that is a little bit more variation that I've added to the Jungle Railway line. I think it's looking absolutely awesome. I know that it's just dirt right now, but in my brain, I can see the thing completed. And let me tell you something, it looks beautiful. Well, Cyberdogs, ever since I broke down the old farmlands to create the automatic greenhouse, things have been looking bad for me from a food perspective. I've had to come over here to Mole City to scrounge some freaking wheat from the villagers, and I've also had to steal a whole bunch of wheat from Beatrice's courtyard. Yeah, we need to get our farm up and cracking as soon as we possibly can, guys. This is getting ridiculous. I can't live on freaking melons. I mean, it's insane. You eat melons and then about 10 seconds later, you start losing freaking health. And I've eaten so many freaking melons right now, I'm feeling kind of sick. I definitely want to start variating my freaking diet, man. We need to get cracking on that Victorian greenhouse as fast as possible. What's cracking, Diablo? Get out of my way there, man. I am busy. Can't you see? Let me just collect some of this wheat here, guys, so we can make a little bit of bread. And then we're going to move over to Mob Castle. We're going to start working on some awesome redstone jazz. So excited about it, guys. Oh, man, can't wait to show you what I got planned. But while we're here, let's take a quick look at the greenhouse. We planted some trees there a couple episodes ago. And as we can see, those trees have grown naturally, looking really nice. Actually, look at that, man. They're all like different levels. They're all at different heights. That's exactly how I wanted it. That is beautiful. What we're going to need to do is get some vinage hanging down from these trees. And now we can figure out how we're going to build the roof on top of this greenhouse. And it's going to have to be about as high as that, the highest tree that we can see there. So that's awesome, Matt. So excited to get cracking on that build in the next couple of episodes or so. But for now, guys, we got some redstone work to do. All right, CyberDogs, I am pleased to announce that it is time to get stuck into the meat and freaking potatoes of today's episode. And the recipe for those meat and potatoes consists of redstone, hopper clocks, monostable circuits, and a whole bunch of other really awesome and really complicated jazz. I hope you guys are ready for some technical Minecraft with Rendiggity Dog, guys. It is going to be absolutely awesome if I can pull this off. I'm not very well known for my redstone. As you guys know, I'm pretty bad with redstone, but I gotta tell you that I've been spending the whole week freaking researching for today's episode, and I think that I have managed to figure out exactly how to achieve our goals today using redstone. So it is gonna be awesome, man. Let's see if we can actually make this happen. Now, since you guys were last inside of the Mob Castle facility, I have done a ton of work. You'll be able to see some of that footage on the next dog mail for those of you guys who want to watch it. But let's just quickly go over what I have done so far. There's a freaking skeleton coming here. But you guys may have noticed that there is a brand new spawning platform over here. I've managed to stick that up, and that skeleton has now fallen into his doom. He's going to go down the death quaduct, and he will be delivered into the processing chute eventually. But as you guys can see, I have made this into a multi-level spawning facility now. There are now three levels to this side of the spawning facility, and I think there's three levels to this side. In fact, I think there's actually four on that side. But you guys can see that the place is starting to look absolutely freaking awesome. Look at this. It just looks, I just love the sort of symmetry of it. I love the industrialness of it. And I'm very pleased to announce that mobs are definitely spawning inside of here. I've put slabbage on every surface basically where I don't want mobs to spawn. And I have been monitoring these spawning pads for the last sort of half an hour or so. And they are definitely spawning mobs inside of them. As you can see, there's a bunch of creepers in here and a spider at the back there, which is not good. That means I've missed a bit of slabbage somewhere. But those creepers upstairs is proof of the pudding that these spawning chambers are in fact spawning mobs, which makes me extremely happy, guys. You know, this isn't going to be the most efficient mob spawner of all time. And I've always said from the beginning that is absolutely fine. That isn't really my intention to make a super efficient mob spawner. All I want to do is make a really cool mob spawner, and one that is going to give us, you know, a decent amount of XP. And not just absolutely insane OP amounts of XP. Now, let's have a quick squiz inside of this one too, so I can just show you guys how much work I've actually put in here. So we've got it. Oh, there we go. A skeleton has fallen to his doom. Goodbye. Enjoy your trip to the death quaduct. Oh my goodness, we're getting attacked from somewhere. It must be from one of these positions, perhaps above us. But yeah, you guys can see I've done a ton of work over here. We've got a whole bunch of spawning to do around there. And yes, another creeper is on his way to be processed, which is excellent. But you know what? This is a little bit dangerous right now. So I think we should just move directly on to working on the redstone for our mob spawning facility. All right, my friends, the thunder and the lightning has begun, which makes me feel like there is no better time than now to get cracking with today's redstone project. It's going to be a complicated one, but we're going to try and make it as simple as possible. To start off with, let's talk about exactly how we want this facility to function. That way, we will have it in our mind what we need to achieve when we get to making our redstone mechanics and our redstone machines. It's actually a really rather simple process that we need to figure out. What we have in our mob spawning facility is a whole array of darkroom spawners on both sides of the center of this room. So we've got like four darkroom spawners on that side. We've got three darkroom spawners on this side. And at the back of each of those spawners is an array of dispensers, Within these dispensers, we have a bucket of water, and the mechanics that we are going to be working on today is finding a way to trigger these dispensers to dispense the water and then to suck that water back up again. It's a little bit more complicated than that though, because of course what we need to do is allow for an amount of time to let mobs actually spawn in these positions. So what we essentially want to be able to do is get these dispensers to trigger, to then trigger again, say 3 or 4 seconds later, and then to not trigger for another 60 seconds. So what we need to do is have a long delay between a double trigger of the dispenser. And that way, the spawning pads will have an opportunity to spawn more mobs. And every 60 seconds or so, the dispensers are going to trigger and wash those mobs into the aqueducts to be delivered into the processing chute. Of course, the most important thing that we need to do, though, is make sure that once the dispensers trigger, they then trigger again so that those water sources are removed, giving the mobs another chance to spawn inside of the spawning pads. All right, my friends, here we are on the other side of the mob spawning facility, and I think I have found a pretty decent spot to set up the brains of Mob Castle. And when I say the brains, essentially what we are going to be creating today is a tiny little computer that is going to be automating the dispensers inside of our Darkroom arrays. I might be giving it a little bit too much credit by calling it a computer, but you know what? I'm gonna go with it, man. Sounds freaking fancy, and as this is going to be the most complicated redstone build that I think I've ever created, I'm pretty much happy to call it a computer and make it sound super freaking awesome. Sorry about that, my friends. Just had to go and deal with an arachnid infestation. Their freaking noises were driving me crazy. I've added some torches into these unfinished arrays also, so hopefully we won't get disturbed while we work on today's redstone project. And we need as much freaking concentration as possible, guys, because this is going to be a complicated one. We are going to start off with by making the hopper clock. Now, it's really, really difficult for me to explain to you guys exactly what a hopper clock is until I've set it up. So I'm just gonna get this thing put together, and I hope that I can remember exactly how it's made. I do believe that it's made something like this. Two hoppers go directly into each other like so. So that's looking pretty good. Then what you need to do is stick something called a redstone comparator on each side of the hoppers like this, facing in this direction. Then on the end of the comparator, we are going to be sticking a block. Then next to the comparators, we are going to be sticking two pistons, I believe. I think it goes something like this. A piston goes on this side and a piston goes on this side. And then I believe the last thing that we need to do is stick a little bit of redstone on either side of the pistons like that. And the last bit is adding a redstone block into this array. And there we have it, my friends, the very first hopper clock of this survival series. I do hope that I have set it up correctly. I wish that I could take the credit for the build of this thing, but unfortunately I cannot. Someone much smarter than I created this thing. I believe that Etho might have played a part in its creation, but it is certainly a piece of a redstone genius. And now let me try and explain to you guys exactly how this works, okay? What a hopper clock is able to do is generate a redstone pulse every X seconds or so. And the way that it does that is a very, very smart, ingenious way. It uses these two hoppers that are facing each other. And essentially what we have here is an infinite loop between this hopper and this hopper. So what we're going to do is we're going to stick some rotten flesh into this hopper, and as you can see, what it is doing is it's transferring its rotten flesh over to this hopper. Now when this one is full, it's going to start transferring its rotten flesh back to this hopper. And when that happens, the comparator gets triggered, a redstone signal gets sent into this block, which then gets sent into this piston, which then retracts and pulls this redstone block in front of this cabling. And that is how we are generating this redstone pulse. Now, I don't know exactly how the thing works, but I do hope that I've explained it in a fairly decent manner. The really important thing, though, for us to realize is that all this is doing is generating a redstone pulse for us automatically every X seconds. And if we want the timing of that to be increased, all we need to do is add more rotten flesh into the hopper. The more flesh we add in here, the longer it takes to send that flesh into the opposite hopper, and the longer it'll take for these pistons to contract and to to trigger this redstone cabling. So you guys can already see that by using this, we are now going to be able to send this redstone signal into this array and into this array, which is going to trigger all of those dispensers. However, the problem that we have right now is that this is a solid redstone signal, and we need this signal to pulse twice instead of be a solid signal. So we need to install something now called a monostable circuit, which is essentially going to turn this solid redstone signal into a single redstone pulse. We'll then be able to turn that single redstone pulse into two redstone pulses, which is going to trigger our dispensers twice, thus making the water come out of the dispensers and then make the dispensers suck up the water directly afterwards. Wow, that was a freaking mouthful. Alright my friends, I know that this is super complicated and I know that I'm probably melting some of your brains right now, but trust me, when it is finished, it is going to be absolutely awesome. And we're going to take it one step at a time, okay guys? And that's going to make it a little bit easier to understand for both of us, trust me. Now the next step in this process, guys, is to turn our consistent redstone signal that we're getting from this redstone block into a redstone pulse. And the way that we do that is by creating something called a monostable circuit. And a monostable circuit looks a little something like this. Don't ask me how it works, but it just works, okay? And the redstone pulse is going to be coming into this cable over here. So when this hopper clock triggers, you'll see there that the redstone signal is constant all the way through here, but it only pulsed through this redstone cable, which is exactly what we need to happen. Right? Because we don't want a consistent redstone signal going into the dispensers, because of course what that'll mean is that they will just trigger and the water will just flow and we won't be able to de-trigger those dispensers. So by having a monostable circuit in between the dispensers and the hopper clock, we are able to trigger a redstone pulse from a consistent redstone circuit, which is exactly what we need. Alright my friends, the next step is a pretty simple one. Now that we've managed to convert our redstone signal into a redstone pulse through this monostable circuit, we need to send that pulse into the dispensers on both sides of our mob castle facility. And all we're going to need to do that, of course, is just to run a whole bunch of redstone cabling into the two spires of the castle. These spires are pretty much going to be the conduits for our redstone pulse. They're going to be taking this redstone signal into the dispensers within the darkroom spawners. But of course, what we need to do is make sure that the redstone signal is strong enough to get there, and we're just going to be using a repeater to do that. And yeah, I've got a whole bunch of repeaters here. So let's get the repeater installed probably in this position over here, I would say. Yeah, that seems like a pretty good one. And that will make sure that that redstone pulse that comes from our monostable circuit is going to continue all the way into the two spires. And eventually, they will end up triggering all of the dispensers. You know what, my friends? I think it's really important that when working on redstone builds like this, every now and then you take a moment to step back and make sure that what you have constructed so far is functioning correctly. You know, it's much harder to fix something at the end than it is at the beginning. So let's just make sure that our build is working good so far. Our hopper clock triggers, there we go, the signal gets turned into a pulse. That pulse then sends its redstone signal into this cable. This cable sends the redstone pulse into this spire and into that spire, and that pulse is going to be triggering our dispensers inside of our darkroom spawners. So far, everything is functioning absolutely beautifully. Now, there's only one more thing that we need to add into the brain of our mob castle over here, and that is a way to get our dispensers to trigger a second time. Remember, what we're trying to do here, guys, is get our dispensers to spit out some water, and then a few seconds later to suck that water up again. And the reason that we want to do that is, of course, so that the mobs that are in the rooms get flushed into the aqueducts, and then there is time for mobs to spawn again. Okay, so there's only one more thing we need to figure out to complete the brain of our mob castle build today, guys. Oh man, this is getting super exciting. So currently what we are able to do with this build is trigger our dispensers once. And what we of course want to do is be able to trigger the dispensers one more time so that they will spit their water out and then a few seconds later suck that water back up again. So we need to figure out a way to get a secondary pulse out of this single pulse that we are getting from our hopper 5 o'clock. And I think that we can do this in a pretty clever way. We're probably going to have to move this torch a little bit up, though. So check it out, right? Our signal from the hopper clock that is getting turned into a pulse is traveling along this redstone cable. So why don't we try and use a little bit of slabbage in this position to steal that pulse in this direction, right? So if we could send the pulse this way, right? Let's just make sure that it's actually working. Let's remove some of this this flesh from the timer. That's going to make the timer trigger faster. If we've done this correctly, we should see the redstone signal traveling up here. Let's just watch and make sure that it happens. Come on, hopper clock. Come on, baby, do your business. Perfect. Okay, so we have a secondary redstone pulse that is now traveling up in this direction. And what we could potentially do is send this redstone pulse back into this cable over here. This is probably a good spot to send it, actually, because we'll send it in front of this repeater so that the pulse doesn't mess around with our monostable circuit down there. So if we did something like this, okay, let's do something like this. Actually, let's do it all the way out here. Why I'm doing this will become clear in a second, guys. Oops, I just broke something. Let's just get that sorted. Okay, so the redstone signal is going to go all the way around like this and then into there again. Now, of course, if we set it up like this, it's going to be broken because the redstone pulse is going to travel at the same speed along this cable as it is traveling along this cable. What we can now do is delay the redstone pulse that is from our secondary line by using repeaters, right? So check it out. If we just install a whole bunch of repeaters along this line, like this, let's just get these installed like so. Okay, just make sure they're all connected. Could we even stick another repeater in here? Yes, we can. Okay, that's excellent. And then let's set the timing of our repeaters all the way to the fullest. Now, of course, what a repeater does is that it delays pulsing the redstone signal when the redstone signal gets to it. So check it out. I think each repeater at full width delays the redstone pulse by 0.4 seconds. So we should, in theory, have a good amount of delay between this redstone pulse and this redstone pulse. Let's just connect it and check it out. So the hopper clock's going to trigger now. There we go. Now we can follow the redstone signal. There we go. Check it out. Boom. Okay, so let's watch this line. It should trigger once, and then a few seconds later, it should trigger again. If that happens, we have achieved our goal. All right, there's the trigger. The water's flowing, and there's the secondary trigger. The water just got sucked up. Excellent. Okay, that is working beautifully, guys. Now let's connect it up to our dispensers. This will be the final test to see if this actually works. All right, guys, here's the test. The hopper clock is about to trigger. That should trigger all of our dispensers. Boom, there goes the water. Okay, it's flushing the mobs, and we should get another secondary signal right away that's going to suck up the water sources. And that is just working beautifully, man. That is absolutely awesome. Look at this. The water dispenses, the mobs are getting flushed down, and then the dispensers are triggered again and they suck that water up, giving the mobs time to respawn inside of the pad. Now we might need to do a little bit of configuring here. We might need to let the water stay there a little bit longer than it is currently. But you know what? We can tweak all of that sort of jazz later on, man. I am just so freaking happy that this redstone build is working. And of course, the more flesh that we add into the hopper, the longer the delay is going to be. And the longer that, the more time there will be for the mobs to spawn inside of the dark room. So that is absolutely fan-freaking-tastic, guys. I'm so excited. I can't even freaking stand on the blocks properly, man. But man, that is absolutely epic. It's working exactly the way that I wanted it to. And this is just beautiful right now, man. Well, guys, I gotta tell you, my brain is now 100% fried. I've just spent the last couple of minutes walking around my flat trying to clear my head. But I tell you what, I am so very pleased with how this build has come out. It is functioning absolutely beautifully, and it is just such a nice and compact build. It's not very complicated. It's using two circuits in a very clever way, and I'm just so happy that it's actually turned out right and that I didn't noob out with Redstone today. In the next episode, my friends, we are going to get all of the dispensers hooked up throughout the Darkroom arrays, and I'm going to finish off all of the building too, and this sucker is going to get up and running, and we're going to see how many mobs we can generate in, let's say, an hour or so. We'll do some timing exercises, but this is absolutely awesome, dudes. I'm probably going to do a little bit of tweaking over here to try get the timing absolutely perfect, and yeah, when we are next together in this build, things are going to be working beautifully. I just want to thank all of you guys who have been helping me out with this particular build. You guys on dogcraft.net that have been helping me out with ideas. A lot of you guys sent me information about the mono stable circuit and all of that sweet jazz. So thank you so much for that, guys. Without you, I could never have completed this build, which is absolutely awesome. Guys, we've only got one more thing to do in today's episode before I'm going to sign off. And that is, of course, to get over to the Doggolith and get a few more of you cyber dogs onto it. Oh baby, nothing quite like ending off an awesome Redstone episode by adding a few of you fine cyber dogs to the Doggolith. And without further ado, my friends, please welcome Cab Football, AC Sputnik, CC Bro 159, and Buddy 870 Gaming from dogcraft.net onto the Doggolith. Good to have you guys. You've been immortalized in the Interbubs forever. And now from YouTube subscribers, we have got Prinny Mail, Stealth Bomber 716, Rambo 5750, and Tyler Gullickson Crest. Welcome to the Doggolith, my friends. Thank you so much for your support and for being subscribers of the Ren Diggity Dog channel. And remember, guys, if you want to stand a chance of being added to the Doggolith, you need to be a subscriber of the Ren Dog channel and leave me a constructive comment here and there on my videos. I choose you guys randomly from there. There is also a thread on dogcraft.net, the official CyberDog fan community, where you can add your YouTube username to stand a chance of being added. Link in the description box below. Thank you so much for watching, my friends. I really hope you enjoyed today's Redstone shenanigans. It was crazy, and I am super stoked that we managed to get a completed. So awesome, man. Mob Castle is going to be so freaking sweet when it's finished. Thanks so much for watching, my friends. This is Ren Diggity Dog signing off, and we will see you in the next episode.